from GP DC.
Absolutely. I feel like a field reporter at the moment.
You literally are.
I literally am. I should be dressed differently, though.
You want to wear like khakis and a safari hat?
I feel like I should be wearing a vest with pockets.
Ooh, that's
like a rugged vest.
Fashionable.
I'm missing a rugged vest.
Well, everybody, welcome to Magic the Amateuring live from GP DC. You can see in the
background. A utility vest.
That's what it's called.
Anyways, you were saying.
If you're watching the video version of this podcast, you can see in the background, day two is still happening behind us. We don't know who won.
No, because literally no one has won yet.
Nobody has won yet.
They haven't even cut to top four yet.
By the time
we are still two rounds out from top four.
We are. By the time you see this, of course, you're in the future, so you know a lot more than we do. You know about the alien invasions. You know about the top four of GPDC. You know
Maria,
about the winning team.
Maria, wake up.
What?
You were talking about alien invasions again?
Oh, huh. Weird. Anyway, GPDC is happening.
Yeah.
You in the future know who won. We don't yet. That's kind of exciting.
Yeah, it is.
So here we are. We're sat high atop above all the action. We had a fantastic weekend here in D.C. What a great city. We visited a lot of monuments.
Yes, we saw Abe Lincoln.
Yeah, we personally met with Abe Lincoln.
Yes, he's very tall.
He just as tall as you would think.
I saw him in portraiture and in sculpture.
We went to a spy museum.
Yes.
We went to a national
portrait gallery.
Yeah, the Washington Monument.
Yes. We went to the Vietnam War Memorial.
And we played magic.
That last one was bleak.
What?
The Not magic? The magic.
Oh, God.
The War Memorial.
The magic was not bleak.
Well, it depends on what part of the day we're talking about.
Okay, so Meghan and I were on a team. This was Team Sealed with Athena Huey, a.k.a. Elantris, who's a streamer on Twitch.
Yep.
It was really, really fun. And I know on past episodes I've been like, oh, I don't like Team Sealed because there's a lot of pressure. Well, I now feel that Team Sealed is one of my favorite formats.
I agree. I had probably the most fun playing yesterday that I've had at any tournament to date.
I agree. It was an enormous amount of fun. We're going to talk, hopefully, with Athena later on in the show. And we'll tell you about our pool and about how we did. It's kind of a fun story. We had some really epic games.
We did. They were insane.
Meghan. We also have some more special guests coming up on the show, including Gaby Spartz, and BDM's going to come on our show.
What?
I'm so excited. This is just going to be a great episode, so you've got all that to look forward to. But before we talk to all of our special guests, I want to say how this journey all started, Meghan.
How did it all start, Maria?
We went and playtested. We playtested Team Sealed with our good friend Judge Rob, friend of the show, and we made a little video about playtesting and why it's important. So take a look / listen.
Hey guys, we're about to practice Team Sealed! So it looks like we'll probably end up splitting red removal.
What card did you just say you wanted to cut?
Saddleback Lecoq.
Get out.
Wait. What the best
Why have you decided to hold some Team Trios or Team Sealed deck building practice?
Because next week is Grand Prix DC, and I'm flying down there to play some Team Trios.
Meghan, what's the best way to sort?
Okay, well, my preferred way to sort is we have by color, including colorless and multicolor, and then at the top we have bombs and removal in one category, then everything that's slightly better than filler, then filler and stuff that we're never playing.
Here I am with my deck that I've made in Team Sealed. I just want you to look at this.
You know, I can cut.
And I also want you to look at this. And I also want you to look at this. And I also want you to look at this. And I also want you to look at every other card I have in this deck. This deck can't be beat going on record right now. This green-black masterpiece is the real deal. Rob, what's for lunch?
Oh. Oh my God, I'm gonna puke.
Why do you think it's important to playtest and do practice group builds?
Just because it's unlike any other deck building situation. It's really hard to get the balance right, I think, when you're trying to build three decks out of a single pool.
what would your advice be? How do you what do you need to host a team sealed practice?
Friends.
And packs.
And packs.
Everybody, we're here chatting with Gaby Spartz, known both for her stream and more recently for doing coverage on the Magic Twitch channel, which is super sweet. And she was also playing this weekend, and she's going to tell us a little bit about a team draft that they did today.
First, I want to ask you, Gabby, how was your weekend?
So my weekend was great. We did a day two. I'm just going to let them finish real quick.
Okay, there's an announcement, you guys. We are actually in the live hall. This is happening. Proof is happening of how live this show is right now. Okay.
So I played in the main event. We finished 5-4. I played with Andrew Beckstrom and Andrew Parnell. They're two of my buddies that I learned how to play Magic with. So.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, it was really fun. Our bowl was bad. We tried really hard. It didn't get there, not even close. We finished 5-4, and it was fine.
You played it out, though. That's Meghan and I can't say that.
We quit like chumps. We were so close. I mean, we got eliminated pretty late into the tournament, so we were like, whatever, let's just finish it. So, yeah. But it was fun.
Nice. And so today you came back on day two, and you guys did a side event team draft.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about how your team draft went.
Because team drafts are notoriously very different from doing a regular draft.
Yeah. So I'll talk a little bit about team draft and why they're like pretty different in that sense. So this is this was organized just with friends. The GP doesn't usually do these, but the way team drafts usually go is you alternate your two teams. You alternate team one, team two, team one, team two. And one of the big things about team drafting is you want to make sure you take cards that are good for your team and also not let the other team take cards that are good for them. Because as opposed to a regular draft where you're like, well, I'll draft my best deck and like hopefully I don't play against that Gideon that I like didn't take. Although you maybe would have taken the Gideon anyway. In team draft, you know your team's going to have to face that card no matter what. So what happens to all the decks is that they get a little underpowered because you're just like constantly kind of hating cards. You have to make that decision. Like, is this card good enough that I want to hate it out of the pack? And that's a line that you kind of have to figure out as you're going through the draft. That said, I just played in a team draft, and it is probably the worst deck I have drafted in Oath of the Gatewatch. Like, not close. Not close.
Were you trying to do too much hating, or what happened? Did somebody train wreck you from the other side?
There's such a thing called the bait and switch, which I think might have happened in this.
No.
So the bait and switch is when somebody lets you have, like, a really good card on the second pack, and you're like, oh, clearly my opponent's in, like, a different color, or, like, the first two picks.
Yeah.
Clearly they're in a different color because, like, why would I be getting this awesome card in this pack, right? But then actually they just, like, let it go, and then they moved into your color. And so everything you get downstream from there is just, like, awful.
What did you get past, curiosity's sake?
So I took, like, a Malakir Soothsayer in pack one, and then they started getting fed some green stuff, like a Birthing Hulk, or... No, I did not have a Birthing Hulk. What did I have? Man, a Seed Guardian. That was like the best, maybe like the best card in the whole deck was the Seed Guardian that I took at some point. And I was like, all right, we'll take the Seed Guardian. So I end up in green-black, which is not a color for allies. So like there's all these allies that, Malakir Soothsayer, for example, right? Great card if you can actually ever activate it.
Yeah.
It doesn't do anything if you can't activate it. And like that's where I was. The curve is like... Wait, what's the one that ingests?
Sludge Crawler?
Sludge Crawler. Yeah. It was like Sludge Crawler into Loam Larva into random 2-2, like topping out a Plated Crusher just because like there's like nothing to play in this.
Why not?
Horrible.
My favorite being two Mind Rakers that have like almost no ingest targets.
Oh, yeah. Actually, there's two Mind Rakers in there that like are just like they're just there.
Hill Giant.
So promptly O2'd so badly that I didn't even play the last round because like when you do a team draft, you take the collective team effort.
Yeah.
And if you're doing too poorly, you don't even have to play the last round. So you already know when you've lost. So didn't even play round three. I didn't have to.
Overall, how was the weekend for you, though?
It was awesome. GPs are super fun. Team GPs in particular are really fun. I mean, you guys, how often have you guys played in team GPs?
It's our second.
Yeah.
Second. They're awesome, right? And it's like... You want to win so badly because you also, like, want to represent for the team and you want to try your best for the sake of the team, too. So you win together, you lose together, and that's a really fun aspect of team drafting. So,
do you have, like, a favorite moment of the weekend?
It wasn't a game that I played. It was one of the games that my friend Andrew played. So the way our pools kind of worked out is we ranked the decks in terms of like how good we thought they were. So at the end of the day, we had a deck that we thought was a 4, that was the one that I was playing, a deck that was a 5, and we rated what we thought the. I'm just gonna wait real quick. It's a lot of fun.
It's okay, ladies and gentlemen.
There you go.
Go for it.
So we were trying to rate like what would we rate these decks out of 10 if we like were to just like rate them. So we had a 4, a 5, and a 7 is what we thought like those decks kind of ended up. And so one of the decks was like a Surge deck that. Like, it had no theme, it was just blue-red cards, but it also had a Chandra, and it had a Tyrant of Valakut. So,
oh, that's pretty nice.
So we're like, all right, this deck, like, doesn't really have a theme, but it's just going to win with Chandras or something. So I turn around, and, you know, in when you're playing in a team GP, you can actively take a look at what your opponent, or, like, what your teammates are playing, and, like, give feedback, and, like, actively interact in the plays. And so we're looking at this, and we're taking a look at what's in his hand, and we're like, opponent has, like, a million flyers, we're going to die to all the flyers in a second.
Yeah.
So Andrew draws a mountain, and he needs mountain to have 3 mountains to play Tears of Valakut, targeting one of the flyers, to trigger Surge on Tyrant of Valakut, to play Tyrant of Valakut, come in with Surge, deal 3 to the other flyer that's like a 2-1 or something, and now Tyrant can block the last creature. It was awesome.
Oh my
that's
god.
Amazing.
Not only was it a sweet
beautiful.
Play, it was so flavorful. It was awesome.
Yeah. Valakut is on point.
Yeah. Exactly. It was raining fire on those flyers.
Oh yeah, it was sweet. That was probably like the best thing that happened. Everything else was just downhill from there.
Nice. That's a pretty sweet story.
Yeah, no, it was fun. It was good. It was real good.
I wanted to ask you quick before you go, just how you've been enjoying being a part of coverage now.
Sure. I loved it. I thought it was really hard, like really challenging, but a good kind of challenging. You know, we kind of like commiserated over our first like coverage.
Yeah, weekend.
Our first coverage weekend. It was really intense, especially since it was both our first times kind of doing it. But we got through it.
Yeah, we did.
I thought things went really well. I really like doing it. I hope I get to do more of it. Yeah, it's fun and it's hard. It's definitely a different set of skills than just like playing regular Magic or anything
Absolutely.
Like that. But I like it a lot.
Well, we both were a huge fan. We think you did a great
job.
Thank
you, guys.
Awesome.
Aww. So we're pulling for you to do more in the future.
That's awesome. Thank you, guys. I love doing it. I hope I get to do it more.
Well, thanks for stopping by Maria and Megan's podcast hangout booth.
Thank you.
Here at GPDC. High five. Okay, we're here with Brian David Marshall. Tell me, how's your weekend going?
It's been crazy. It's been a lot of fun. It's... you know, watching teams is one of my favorite formats of all time in Magic, and I love watching people play Magic, and watching groups of friends play Magic is just the best, because so many times when you watch a match of Magic, it's just head down in the cards, but if like, the three of us are playing together, I'm leaning in, I'm talking about your cards, you're looking over at my board, it's like it's like Magic on steroids. It's just like it's like so much more, or maybe on mood enhancers.
Yeah.
Because you know what I mean? It's just like everyone's just more engaged and social, and you know, there's like 6 people all like interacting. I love it.
So someone get a drug test in here.
Yeah.
This Magic is on something.
You've been interviewing and talking to a lot of people across the course of the weekend.
Yes, absolutely.
What have some of your favorite stories that have come out?
So one of my favorite stories is I was talking to a player, and I feel bad that I don't remember his name right now, but he was an Ohio-based player who was just finished serving in the Air Force.
Oh, wow.
Okay, and he's just came home, and he's coming to his first GP, and he's like, gets to play Magic and see all his old Ohio buddies. But he was stationed in Germany. So, like, he's, like, looking at, like, Andrea Gans and Florian Koch and... those guys, and he's like, oh, I played Magic with these guys in Germany, so it's like my Ohio buddies and my Germany buddies. They're like, oh, that's, you know, you're in the Air Force. We had a couple guys at the last event who'd been stationed in Okinawa, and he's like, oh, no, I read that story. I was stationed with those guys in Okinawa, too. It was so, like, it was so wild to see them, you know, in coverage.
That's
so
awesome.
It was just kind of cool.
Magic brings everybody together. DC and Team Sealed brings everybody together.
Exactly. Someone get... the drug test in here.
Okay,
this
Meghan.
Magic's on
okay.
drugs.
Okay.
Is that the theme?
So I'm just, look, I'm really insistent on fair play for everybody. Okay. So what do you think makes, like, a team GP so dynamic and so happening?
I mean, I think it's a number of factors. I talked about, like, that engagement level where it's a different, literally a different perspective instead of just looking down at your cards, looking around at the players you're playing with. But it's also that aspect of, like, it's just this great opportunity to force people who claimed they were quitting Magic or I'm never going to play again, no more GPs for me.
Yeah.
That this is the opportunity to drag them back into the game, right? You're like, all right, we're going. We need a third, Scott. You got to come out and hang out with us this weekend. And, you know, you see that time and time again. You see faces and players that you just haven't seen in a while. And they inevitably have a great time. They inevitably try to remember what their Magic Online password is. You know what I mean? Like, it's just always a great jumping back on point for people who are veterans of the game because it has such a long tradition among the you know, old school players.
Right. Did it used to be called Team Trios or is that something different?
I think Team Trios is always kind of the sort of like official DCI reporter name.
Okay.
But, you know, it used to be that you would play Team Sealed and then the way the draft portion worked is you'd play Team Sealed on day one of whether it was a Pro Tour or a Grand Prix. Day two was Team Rochester draft.
That's where everybody got to see the picks, right?
Yeah. So let's say the three of us are sitting on one team. We're seated here. Who's our team? What who are we facing? It's Marshall, Kenji, and Woody.
Yeah.
Sounds great.
So Marshall, Kenji, and Woody are sitting right there, and we're gonna make them look really bad.
Okay. Perfect.
We're gonna play them like fiddles.
Okay.
So we would open up a booster pack, and let's say it was Woody's pack to open. So Woody would pick a card, he would confer with the team, he'd pick a card, then Marshall would pick a card, then I'd pick a card, you'd pick a card, Meg would pick a card, and then the last player over there would pick up two cards, and it would wheel back.
What?
And it's all done face up, and so you're I'm playing here, you're playing there, and you're playing here. You're playing directly across from each other. So you're building your decks on the fly, and it's just this brinksmanship game of like island walkers and color hosers, and it's like so much fun, and it's like the best part is the draft. I'll be honest.
Yeah.
The playing is great, but it's.
It's not such as great a mind as the draft. Game.
It's just that insane is mind game.
So crazy.
It's one of my favorite formats. It's the only format I've ever won money on the Pro Tour playing, so I'm particularly fond of it.
Fair enough.
Well, this sounds
Fair
great.
Enough.
Let's bring it back.
I know, right? I want to try that now.
I want to try it. It sounds really interesting.
Thank you. We're going to go give that a shot.
Yeah. Yeah.
It sounds amazing.
But you're so right. This format brings out people who haven't played in a long time, a lot of new players who are teaching other players to play, come be on our team and I'll be in the middle seat and I'll help you out on my side.
Right.
Stuff like that.
Did you see Chris Anderson in the Kiefers?
No.
He's playing with these two young, Chris Anderson's a guy who's been playing the game for a while. He's like a, you know, SCG circuit guy and a GP competitor and he's a veteran, you know, still young by my, you know, my standards anyway, but you know, a veteran. He's playing with two, you know, teenagers that he met playing on the SCG Open who are just great young players. He's just like, I think these kids have, like, prodigy in them. So he's like, I'm...
Wow.
And they have a third brother who's playing on a different team, and their mother wouldn't let them all play together because they play too much. That's also one of my favorite
stories. That's very smart. But you know what? Having grown up with a brother with whom I fought constantly, I think she's making the right decision.
It's neat to see people who are, you know, playing this format very casually as well. We had a friend, actually, who went to play Two-Headed Giant and was telling us stories about his opponents and calling cards by other names, like calling Saddleback Lagak, this little cutie. And I'm going to play, what card do you think in the set you would call Jell-O Man?
If they're like, we should play the Jell-O Man.
Play the Jell-O Man.
Containment Memory.
Yes, you're right.
Yes, I'm good at this
Nailed
game.
Nailed it. And I think it's just really cool to see a combination of spikes and of kids and of parents and of people helping their brothers and sisters out playing. So, I don't know. I'm an advocate for more Team Seal. This has just been a blast.
Absolutely. It doesn't come around often enough.
What's next for you, BDM?
You know what? The pre-release.
Oh yeah!
Shadows of Innistrad pre-release.
Yeah, it's coming up.
Nice.
And, you know, I'm gonna make sure I'm gonna block out. I've already sort of talked to my wife and I've said like, look, I know I've been away like, you know, infinite weekends in a row.
Yeah.
But in a couple weeks, you know, you're gonna do something else on Saturday. And I'm just gonna play pure release.
I'm going to disappear.
Yeah.
It's very flavorful.
Spooky.
So how are you thinking of the set so far?
I'm excited. I still don't fully know what you know my thing is gonna be in this set. Like Innistrad, I had spider spawning.
Spider
that was
spawning.
My thing.
That was your deal.
And I don't know what it is, but I know there's some graveyard stuff going on. We've already seen like Relentless Dead, and we've seen Delirium. So I mean, I love cards changing zones. Yeah. That's what I like to do in Magic, right? I like to discard a card to draw a card. I like to mill cards from my library to my graveyard, return cards from my graveyard to play. Like, I just want cards moving around. I just want an energetic board.
That's a great way to put it.
An energetic board. I like it.
Yeah,
I like it a lot.
That's always been what I like in Magic. So I'm looking forward to seeing how Shadows Over Innistrad is going to deliver that.
Wonderful. Well, we're gonna call. Wait, I have one more question to ask you. So you're a great baker. A lot of people don't know this about you. You made some fantastic cookies this weekend.
Yes.
If you're going to give one baking tip to people who are just starting out, what would it be?
Salt.
Salt?
Salt.
Okay.
More salt than a normal recipe calls for. Be a little more salt. Like, salt makes things sweeter. It makes, like, sour more sour. It just, like, heightens. It's like performance-enhancing drugs for baking.
And
bring it around full circle.
Someone call the feds. This baking's on drugs.
Well, thanks so much for sitting down and talking to us, PDM.
My pleasure.
It was great. All right, we're here with Doc.
Yes.
All right, tell us what happened. You just said you just won a 20-minute judge call?
I did, yeah. So it's round, I guess, the second to last round, and my team is 0-4. So we're playing for points and cash. So we wanted to win, obviously. I'm playing against some nice guys, and so there was a misunderstanding. Basically, I was way ahead on board. I had a Bane of Balaghed in play, and I had been attacking with him for 5 turns. So he had very few permanents left.
Oh my god!
I attacked with it again, and he takes 2 of his permanents and makes a sort of scooping motion, and I thought he was scooping the game. So I scooped up my lands, and he said, no, I'm not scooping. So I put my lands back down right away.
Yeah.
Then he puts his 2 permanents into exile, calls the judge. He says he's not sure whether I touched lands and permanents or just lands, and his story sort of changed a little bit over the course of time, which was kind of in my favor. And then, there was the ruling went in my favor, which is good. We called the head judge. Both the floor judge and the head judge ruled in my favor, primarily because almost all the cards in my hand were also lands, and the other one was a sorcery, so there's no way I could have actually angle shot that. So it was something where the judges could confirm based on my hand that I wasn't trying to cheat, obviously, because I was massively ahead on board, and so that won us the game and therefore the match.
Oh, wow.
Nice.
Stressful.
So it appealed all the way up.
You went to the Supreme Court of this tournament.
I'm not used to arguing in that format, but arguing with a judge, I'm okay with.
Yeah, you are a lawyer. Come on.
this is your future.
Yeah,
I didn't have to argue much with the judge, fortunately. The guys were pretty understanding.
So how's your weekend been?
Very good. I have a wonderful team and really like the teammates, Brendan McNamara and Hunter Slayton from Hipsters of Coast. Wonderful Brooklyn guys. And have been having a great time. Wonderful people, too.
Nice.
Awesome.
Well, thanks for telling us your judge story.
Yeah.
And good luck in these last 2
thanks
rounds.
Thanks so much. I got to go because pairings are up.
Okay.
But, thanks so much.
This is real life, people. Go run, Gabe. Run. Okay, here we are. Team the Gnarled Pack.
Yes.
Together
again. I
don't
think you can say team in front of it.
Oh, just
the Gnarled Pack. Exactly.
With Athena Huey. She was our third and here in GPDC.
Yes.
Athena, how was the weekend overall for you?
It was pretty good. I had a really fun time. Glad I came.
Yeah, agree.
Yeah. How do you feel like it compared to previous GPs that you've been to? Like, do you like limited better? Do you like standard better? Do you like team better? What's your thoughts?
I liked the team aspect of it. I really, really wish that there was team constructed GPs.
Whoa.
That'd be a lot of fun.
That's kind of cool.
I liked the idea that you could still do really poorly or get mana screwed and still potentially win. And it was also really fun hanging out with you guys.
Aww.
It was fun hanging out with you too.
It was.
But I don't know. I always feel weird traveling for limited GPs because there's so much variance in just what your pool looks like and what other people's pools look like that it can be kind of hard to get super excited about it.
No, I see what you're saying because we did a practice event, Team Sealed event, on Friday before, you know, the main event on Saturday, and our pool was, I would say,
atrocious.
80% 80% weaker than our pool on set. I mean,
it was hot garbage.
It was so
that's
trash.
A technical term.
It was so trash.
Like, and it made it an enormous difference. Our decks just like so underpowered compared to what we were seeing.
Do you guys remember like what our rares were? I remember we had like an Oath of Nyssa, and then no, it was an Oath of Chandra, an Oath of Jace, a Call the Gatewatch, a Seagate Wreckage. And those are like the playable things.
Yeah. We had some basement rares, let me tell you.
Some basement rares.
New term, coining it now.
Nice.
But if we fast forward to Saturday, our pool was
much better.
Much better. In fact, it contained not one, but two P-dubs. That's what I'm calling planeswalkers, including this one who makes lovely plant tokens. Nyssa and a Gideon.
Yeah, man. We still, I feel like, in terms of like the average number of Oblivion strikes that a team should open, we are so far, we are so far below average.
We only had
the
one.
Isolation zones.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
We just got...
Between the pool on Friday and the pool on Saturday, we had a total of two isolation zones and one Oblivion strike.
Very true. We did, however, on Saturday have a lot of good red removal, and I think that was something... a point of contention that ended up, you know, or maybe we might have misbuilt a little bit. So what we built was Meghan played a very controlling blue-white deck, which was a really cool deck, actually.
Big butts,
cannot lie.
No.
And then your Sphinx of the Final Word cannot deny.
No, it certainly
can't be denied.
Yeah.
And I played a green-red Fatties deck, which was the same sort of deck that I played on Friday, which turned out to be a little too... slow sometimes when I was playing versus black-white allies or another aggressive build. But if it could get to the late game, usually did pretty good because, as we said, we had a lot of red removal. Because of that, I gave some of my removal, a Boulder Salvo and a Touch of the Void, to Athena, who is playing black Devoid, splash red.
It was pretty great. My deck was awesome.
I loved your deck.
I feel like I had the coolest deck out of everyone.
Both of yours are really cool in different ways, and mine was kind of derp town.
Tell us a little bit, Athena, about the deck that you built.
Yeah.
Because we call it Black Devoid, but there's a ton of different ways that could go.
It was pretty aggro, the deck, but it also had a few ways to like finish out the late game. We ended up with a ton of the 2/2 Death Touching Eldrazi.
Slaughter Drone.
That card's great. And I don't know. I felt like the only games I was losing were games to really big bombs that you just can't really deal with, like Linvala's
card.
It
happens. I dealt with
sometimes an
double world breakers.
Yep, plays the Linvala and you're just like, okay.
G to the G.
Or if I got mana screwed. And I think that's coming back to what you're talking about with misbuilding. That might have been the issue, was that playing colorless, we were playing, I think, 9 colorless sources.
We were playing 9 colorless sources.
It was a lot. And I think that perhaps... with the 9 colorless as well as the black, the splashing the red might have been a bit much.
A bit risky.
Yeah, I kind of agree. And watching your deck play out, there were a lot of times that I felt like you had a Touch of the Void in hand.
Yeah.
And there was just like no red mana to cast it. And it's like, yep, that definitely, if it comes up more than once, it's probably
a problem. Yeah.
Something notable about your deck is how many wastes you were playing. Three. For Walker of the Waste, which you had two of.
That card's great.
So
what
sick.
Was the biggest... Do you remember what the biggest a Walker of the Wastes ever was?
I think it was a 7-7.
Oh, my God.
Trample! And the best was that my opponent didn't realize it was a 7-7, so we blocked assuming it was like a 4-4. And I was like, oh, but I have to race. He's like, oh, I guess you do.
Yes.
Brilliant.
And it has Trample, so you're also just taking more damage too.
Meghan, you had probably the most epic game of all time and space.
Oh my goodness.
Tell us about it.
So this was, in the second round, we got a draw. So my first game, I mulliganed to 5, lost super quickly, as you often do on a mulligan to 5. Game 2 proceeded to take about 40 minutes, and
yikes.
I won in extra turns.
Sounds like a nightmare.
So in the course of this game, I'm on the draw, because with my deck, I always chose to draw. So as I like to say, I won all of my die rolls because every time my opponent won, they chose to play. And every time I won, I chose to draw.
You've cracked the system.
So I only ever won die rolls. Anyways, So he played like a Kiora on 4, and then I turned around and played like some things, and I played a Gideon eventually, and like killed the Kiora, and we both like built out our boards. They're huge. I have like Sphinx in play and a Benthic Infiltrator, and he has like 12 million creatures and a Dampening Pulse. And so I like emblem my Gideon so that my creatures are all back to where they were before. Gideon dies, and eventually like it gets to this place where my opponent is at 1 and then surges a crush of tentacles.
Oh. Because I remember looking over at you and seeing all of your creatures back in your hand. I was like, what just happened?
Yeah. And this is after I had, because I had 2 Spawnbinder Mages in play, so I was tapping a lot of things because I was getting in with some flyers. I had like an Angel of Renewal and like some other flyers. So I would tap their flyers every turn.
Yeah.
And get in. And so I was letting him get in with the Bane of Balaged and exiling my lands because I was like, I don't really need to do this anymore. I'm going to kill him soon. So I'm down to like 5 lands in play at this point because he's attacked me with Bane a couple of times. Point is, I still had my emblem in play. So I like smite the octopus token, play my Benthic Infiltrator, and hit him for the last point of damage.
Oh, it was so good.
It was so sweet.
Especially because it was extra turns.
Yeah. If only it had been game 3.
I know. Well, what are you going to do?
I thought it was game 3. I looked over and I was like, oh my goodness, we did it!
We did it! Oh,
well. It was like game 2.
So what happened is we went win, draw, win, win.
Lose, loss.
So we were like on a roller coaster. We were like, yes, this is the best ride ever. And disappointing drop. But I mean, overall, it was so fun and so much more fun than I actually thought it was going to be. I thought I was going to be stressed out because I was like, oh no, my wins hinge on my team doing well or whatever. But in the end, that's not how I felt. And I really think we did play well, and we did a lot better at this team sealed event than we did at our first one.
Oh, absolutely.
So that's improvement, and that's
something to look to. I think our first one, we immediately went 0-3.
Yeah, something like that. It wasn't that good. It wasn't that good. So yeah, I don't know. I had a really fun time. Maybe I feel like drafting some, like just a little draft. Because I have yet to open an expedition, you guys, ever. Literally ever. Have you opened expeditions, Athena?
Yeah.
Okay. Megan's open too.
Yeah.
I've only opened one.
This is my life.
I have to say, like you mentioned, it was, like, I tend to get really anxious when I'm playing. Or just, like, I get stressed out.
Yeah.
And, like, having you guys there, I was not nearly as stressed.
Yeah, that's so true.
Especially, I feel like, sitting in the middle, I was like, oh, I'm only, like, I'm sandwiched between 2 people that I know and like. Like, this can't be, like, whatever happens, it's not the worst thing that'll ever happen.
You're the turkey in our burger.
Why are we eating a turkey burger?
I kept consulting with Meghan on my keeps. I'm like, should I keep this? And Meghan's like, I don't know, it's up to you. So I was carrying the burden of my own decisions.
What if we're a macaroon?
Oh, that's way better. What flavor?
Oh man, what flavor macaroon should we be?
I've never had a macaroon.
Are you serious?
What? Confession.
Oh my goodness, macaroons are great.
Yeah, they're unlike anything else. Like there's nothing else
crunchy?
Like a macaroon. Yes. Yeah. But it's also soft.
All right. I'm in. What was your favorite moment of the weekend, Athena?
It was probably the team that we played in the feature match.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, that was
just because there were a huge riot. So during this game, I think my opponent cast 6 rares in a row against me.
Yeah,
turn
I
after
saw.
Turn.
It was insanity.
It was totally bonkers.
It was pretty insane. And then the next game, I saw like 3 different rares that I hadn't seen before.
What
and I looked over and I was like, I really hope you guys are winning because there's no way I can beat this deck.
And I feel like Maria and I have to thank you for taking that round.
You took the hit.
Because we did win because our opponent's decks were not good. Like, they had taken all the rares and put them in 1 deck that you were playing against.
But they were so wonderful. They were so wonderful and nice.
Yeah.
And it was really funny because we were surprised at being called to the feature match.
Yes.
There was no video coverage, but they did do a little interview with us as a team, which you can see on YouTube, and we've linked to it on our Twitter at MtAcast. But, like, they wanted to get video of us playing. So it was really great to play these guys who were just shocked that they were going to the feature match area. They're like, what the heck? We're not even 2-0, you know? And they had actually planned a drop to go play Two-Headed Giant.
Which they were dropping at 1-0-1. Like, they hadn't lost anything.
They were just like,
they were
out.
Just like, we're done. Peace.
I think, though, the real part of the story was that they signed up for the tournament thinking Team Sealed meant two-headed giant.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Oh, that was beautiful.
Those guys are great.
That was a beautiful story. That was so good. I forgot about that.
I was proud. This is my proud moment of the weekend. Playing. Yeah. Meghan witnessed, and it happened in a couple games, where I managed to wipe my opponent's board and not wipe mine using Kozilek's return. Yeah. I think that was probably some of my proudest plays, because I had to do like a little bit of work, like maybe two turns ahead of time, thinking ahead to plan out so that I could either, you know, fake them out into attacking me or blocking the way I wanted them to, and then being like, Kozilek's return, wipe your board. I once did it with a Thought Not Seer, and then I got to draw a card, and I just felt like, I have a creature out, you have nothing, I drew a card, I'm king of the world. it was my Titanic moment.
King of the world!
Yeah, that was really fun. But I don't know. Yeah, it was really great, and it was just a total riot. And I'm really excited for when this comes up, like next year, the one time that it does or whatever.
Absolutely. You guys already know my bad beat story, but I'll tell it for the sake of the show.
Okay.
You guys were around for this. My opponent goes like turn 2 Hedron Crawler, turn 3 Cultivator Drone, turn 4 another Cultivator Drone, turn 5 Deceiver of Form.
Oh yeah, I saw this.
No big deal. It's an 8-8 in play on turn 5 or whatever, and I'm just like, great. I can definitely win against this card. And so I'm just like, you know, I'm doing whatever I can. I like chump a couple of times, I think. And then he has like all of these like stupid, you know, derpy ramp creatures out. And then Deceiver of Forms has its like upkeep or like the beginning of combat trigger.
Yeah, it gets to become.
And game 1 turns over an Endbringer. And attacks me with 4/5/5s.
Yeah,
and I was like,
that happens.
I'm losing this very quickly from here. Because not only am I being attacked with these 3/5/5s or 4/5/5s, but next turn my opponent is definitely casting an Endbringer against me. And there is still a Deceiver of Forms in play. So I like lost. And then game 2, basically the same thing happens, except, you know, the Deceiver of Forms comes on a more reasonable turn, like actually turn 7, I think, and without any of those ramp creatures. So all of the ramp creatures are like untapped in play because he tapped all of his lands. So he has like, you know, 3, like a Hedron Crawler, Cultivator Drone, another stupid, you know, ramp card. Up, like, combat trigger, flips over a Bane of Balaged. Attacks me with 3 Bane of Balaged, and I have to exile 6 permanents. And I was just like, congratulations, sir. Your deck is really doing it. Like, you're really doing it.
That's living the dream right there.
Oh, it was so bad. It was so bad.
It was like how I felt when I saw World Breaker in 2 games, one right after the other. My worlds were broken.
Absolutely.
Utterly and completely. Well, thanks for coming and talking to us, Athena. We had a great time playing with you.
I had a great time playing with you guys.
Gnarled pack
so
power.
Much. Yeah, man. The Gnarled pack.
we should go out snapping.
Yeah, I just feel like you need to put snaps in it.
The Gnarled pack.
Well, that's our episode, everybody.
Yeah, man. Thanks for joining us here at Grand Prix Washington, D.C. We super recommend Team Sealed tournaments. They're so much fun. It's just a great and totally unique Magic experience.
Absolutely. So, Meghan, what are you looking forward to coming up in the coming Magic days?
Well, I'm super excited, obviously, for the pre-release of Shadows over Innistrad. Yeah. And we've got a standard Grand Prix coming to Minneapolis.
So excited.
Which usually you will only hear me say standard as standard. But it's in Minneapolis, so we're excited.
Yes, and it's coming up when?
It is coming up at the very last weekend in May.
So Memorial Day.
Yes.
So it's going to be a sweet weekend. Maybe we will be outside barbecuing.
Yeah, man.
Well, the event's going on. I shouldn't make that promise.
Outside the venue? I think that's also illegal.
I can't get
those
permits.
It's like, I don't think you can just barbecue on the sidewalk downtown.
They're like, excuse me, miss.
You can't have a grill here?
It's illegal in 100 ways.
Like, actually 100.
And also, I'm going to grill meat that's, like, endangered, so it's illegal in extra ways.
No, sounds good.
It's going to be human meat.
Well, do you know, like, you never expect the cannibalism reference.
You never do.
Like, you never really, it always just comes out of straight left field.
So I'm going to take a leap and play standard that weekend.
Me too. We're very excited. You can watch us fall on our faces.
Or soar into the clouds and
Then fall on our faces.
Yep. Anyway, we just wanted to say thanks for tuning in this week. And remember, of course, to support us on Patreon. Patreon.com/MTAcast.
Absolutely.
Every little bit helps. The professor is going to have this video up online for you to see as well if you've heard the audio version and want to see everyone's lovely faces.
Check it out.
Thursday.
Yes.
Of course, follow us on Twitter at MTAcast.
Mm-hmm.
Check us out on magicthamaturing.com for every single one of our back episodes, including one with Noah Bradley. He was here this weekend. We talked about him last
week. He was great.
He's great. I bought a print from him, so you'll see it hanging up in our podcast studio in a future episode.
It'll be great. Really, it's beautiful.
So that's all coming up. Of course, thanks for being our listeners. You're all wonderful human beings.
Yep. Find us on Twitter at MTAcast, online, magictheamaturing@gmail.com, magictheamaturing.com.
We have everything.
We have all of it. on listened audio.
Yes.
Stitcher, iTunes.
Yeah. And online.
Online.
I'm horny_unicorny.
And I am ice cream socialist.
And we're having our picture taken.
Until next time.
Good luck. High five.